next session is a leadership keynote on the topic, Fast Track the Digital Journey for Your Enterprise. And our keynote speaker is Mr. Ganesh Lakshminarayanan.
My name is Ganesh. I represent Airtel. I'm responsible for the Airtel Enterprise business. Super excited to be part of this event. The eastern part of India is truly going through a big transformation in a lot of different ways. And it has a deep culture, really hardworking people, a lot of amazing resources, natural resources. I think it's a beautiful untapped opportunity. And I hope this session and this conference and the discussions we have today in this is really going to help us accelerate growth in this area. And in that process, I also want to share some of our thoughts on digital journey for your enterprise. I think digital transformation and digital journey are overused words in the post-pandemic era. And it's a very, very important topic because the pandemic taught us a lot of lessons. And the most important lesson it taught us was that in a country where we know exactly where the pizza we ordered is in every second, and we have beautiful digital platforms for us to help us order pizza, various kind of food, and track them so closely, we really did not know where our oxygen cylinders were. We did not really know where our medicines were. So while this digital transformation has been a broadly used word, and you see a lot of amazing startups who have built some really, really useful applications which have transformed the ways we live. But the digital transformation goes much more beyond than ordering food online, ordering clothes online, or ordering stuff online. So what should digital transformation really mean for all of us? And I want to start with the kind of enterprises we have. We either have enterprises which we call them B2B, which deals with other businesses. You might be serving, if you take my business, is the Airtel Enterprise business, the top 2,000 companies in India are my customers. These are business customers. They are serving their end consumers. It goes all the way from SBI, HDFC Bank, ASICS Bank, to ITC. And they have their end consumers. So this is a B2B side. And then there is the B2C side of businesses, which could be Amazon, Swiggy, Zomato, Nykaa, which is a great example of a company which has gone unicorn, even ITC, which is serving end consumer through their consumer division. These are services companies who have end consumer, who's basically a one customer on the other side. And if you look at what digital transformation should bring, they bring different things to these two different set of companies. When I say a company is digitally transforming, you will see few things which are better when digital comes into play. In our business, which is a B2B business, if we had a very solid digital sales engine, the sales reps will be a lot more productive, they'll be a lot more happier, because now a lot of that sales is happening online. In India, in this context, in most B2B companies, it's very difficult to replace a salesperson. We are still a very relationship-centric country. In the B2B setup, a salesperson or a key account manager or a customer success manager, whichever way you call it, is still an important part of the sales front end. You won't be able to 100% replace it digitally unless you are you're dealing with a very, very structured product. Even then, people need that high touch. But a digital sales engine there can actually offload regular orders, ordering process can be offloaded. So the solutioning and selling is still done through the salesperson. So the first thing which will come to mind is the sales rep productivity. Second is customer acquisition. Digital can definitely be a big part of customer acquisition in the B2B space, especially if you are selling to SMBs. There are 2.5 lakh SMBs in this country. There is a way to reach them digitally, which can definitely be done once your assets are ready and available. For example, we have an asset called Airtel Thanks for Business, where every customer, small and big, have their dedicated portal. They would be able to log on to that portal. They will be able to access the CAM and their service account manager from the portal itself if they need. Or they should be able to look at their inventory, what products they bought from Airtel, Any upgrades and downgrades can be done online. So this platform which we are building, and it's still in work and it's available very soon this year, is going to be a phenomenal way for us to help our sales reps offload some of their transactions online. And it's going to still help our service people to serve their customers digitally, so that whenever there is a problem, whenever there is a order delivery, those statuses can be obtained anytime online without calling those salespeople and service people. Again, ease of doing business. You will be able to pay online, you will get to know products online, you will be able to ask for help online, and digital can bring this to a B2B business. And customer experience, obviously, you know, we would love to serve you, serve ourselves in most of these situations. Wherever we could do it, that's great. With the full knowledge, the B2B world, if the digital experience stops at some point of time, there is always help immediately after. So that's the kind of the role digital transformation plays in enterprises. But in the B2C world, it's very, very different. I ran the Dell consumer services business before I joined Airtel. And these customers were able to configure their PCs, buy their PCs online, get their support for their PCs online, get their accessories for customers online. And using digital and using a very, you know, solid digital marketing tools, we were able to attract people to that website so they can buy online. So customer acquisition becomes a very big part of your B2C company's digital transformation, as opposed to a B2B where it's actually meant for sales reps. You should be able to increase share of wallet. Once the person comes online, you should be able to increase the share of wallet in that customer using digital focus, right? This is definitely important in the B2C space. Ease of doing business and customer experience are common. While it might mean different things for different B2B and B2C customers of yours, but it's ultimately pointing to make sure that they can do their regular things like looking at their invoice, downloading the invoice, checking for delivery, finding out, you know, how the quality of service is. All that, if it can be made digitally, that means that customer experience and ease of doing business goes up. So I think what is very, very interesting for us is that the digital transformation, even though it's overhyped, overused, means little different for B2B and little different for B2C. Now, to make that happen, what are the customers looking for? So this is what we are looking for. So if I'm serving a B2B customer, and as opposed to an end consumer, if my customer is a business customer, they are coming to my digital assets for knowing my products and solutions. If I am selling, for example, an Airtel IQ solution, which is our communication platform as a service, or we are selling our private cloud solution, people will want to come to our digital asset to get to know that. They would also want to make sure that this digital asset is used for easier way of transacting with us. You know, we were in Dell, we used to have all the run rate orders. So if you're a company, for example, if you are ITC and you have a desktop notebook, we have standardized on it, and the procurement division can buy those desktop notebooks on the website based on your rate contract, based on your configuration. In fact, even the end user can place an order for a laptop using that website. We call it premium things. In Airtel, we are doing a similar thing. If you are a B2B enterprise and you want additional link or you want a broadband, you should be able to come to your portal and be able to check the feasibility, so whether it is available, buy it at the pre-configured, pre-contracted price using digital portal. And I think that's the best way we think the B2B customers are going to leverage their digital assets. Seamless access to sales and service. I mentioned that if the digital experience stops, they shouldn't be left hanging. Immediately support should be available and should be supported through digital, as opposed to, you know, people picking up the phone and calling. That is why we have enabled, and using our platform called Airtel IQ, we have enabled click to call on our website portal so that if you are stuck, you can just call the customer from then and there. And then after sales, billing, payment services, this is what a customer of yours, if they are serving a B2B customer, they're looking for, as opposed to a young consumer, they are looking for the visibility of the brand. They want to see brand loyalty. I mean, our digital assets are a big way to build brand loyalty. You see all the product recommendations, star ratings you have on your website. That's one way to build the brand loyalty. Ease of reaching you. They shouldn't be calling to place an order. They should be able to click two clicks. You can place an order. ease of buying from you, right? We don't want to make sure that it's very difficult to buy, call a call center, or go to a store. And digital should be able to, for example, if I want to buy a Brooks Brothers shirt, or I am looking to buy a particular size of a pant, rather than going to a store and finding out it's not available, it'd be easy for me to put this location, my location, the stores nearest to me, place the order so that the store can deliver. That's a great way of making sure that the ease of purchase is there in a B2B setup and superior postal experience. So this is the big difference between a B2B and a B2C customer when it comes to digital transformation. And it's not a universal thing we can apply to all companies. But all of this is driven by one thing. All of this is driven by the enormous accumulation of data. All of this we talked about, you know, ability to find you online, purchase online, depends on customers knowing all of our products, we knowing all of our customers, we knowing their purchase history, and this data is going to keep growing. And with advanced connectivity coming in, with storage coming in, data will be the most important thing for the future. It is not only about a company knowing their end consumer. With 5G, with IoT, you would also know what the products are doing. For example, if you bought a device and the device has an IoT chip enabled in it, let's say you have bought a generator, right? And with an IoT chip enabled in it, the manufacturer of the generator should be able to know exactly the condition of the generator, collect data on the generator, ability to understand when to do a service intervention, when to do a service warranty cleanup. So not only the customers are talking to collecting data, we are actually collecting data on all these devices. For example, in India today, there are 14 million IoT devices, 7 million of them are running on Airtel platform. And this is only going to explode. Every fan is coming out of the Wi-Fi chip right now. So what if tomorrow every big equipment you buy, fridge, comes with an IoT chip and it's actually communicating to the manufacturer certain parameters before the fridge goes bad, the manufacturer will be able to intervene. And this is going to be real, and it'll be real when 5G comes in, because 5G brings enormous density. What 5G is going to bring is the number of devices it can support in a particular area compared to 4G, it will be many fold. So many more devices can use that spectrum compared to what we do today, which means not only cell phones will be connected to 5G, every fridge could be connected to 5G, every one of the most expensive equipment in our companies can be connected to 5G, so that they're talking to the manufacturers and telling them where they are. Imagine the problem we talked about, right? Every gas cylinder, we didn't know oxygen cylinders. What if the product market fitted in a way that it actually became so much easier for price points came down, the IoT price points came down, the 5G made it available, universally available. You will know an oxygen cylinder where it is, because oxygen cylinders and oxygen tankers will be in constant communication with the platform which is tracking them. Today it is not there, but it will be available. It will definitely become a reality one day. So if you look at the data and if you look at the nature of this digital transformation, what customers want, what we want to achieve, there are five things which are going to be very critical. And I'll come from the bottom up because that's the most important foundation. You will need secure data. All this data we talked about cannot be left alone without properly controlling who's allowed to collect it and who's allowed to access it and who's allowed to analyze it. All these three will become very, very critical. And to make that happen, you can't bring all this data to a central location, because the latency requirements of some of this data will be so big that you can't take it all the way physically 600 kilometers away, make a decision and come back. So just give you an example, right? You know, we have all these huge electrical transformers, and these electrical transformers heat up sometimes. And if they heat up beyond a point, they need to be shut down. And the electrical transformers are always telling what the temperature is. Now today, for us to know the temperature, bring it back to a data center, analyze it and say, okay, there's a red flag now, shut down the transformer. All of that should happen within 100 milliseconds. Today, electrical companies are running huge cables You know, one company alone ran 250 kilometers of cable to make sure that this latency can be maintained. Tomorrow with 5G and with IoT, the same thing can be done without that cable. But we can't bring the data back to the data center. It'll be going to the nearest data center so that the latency even becomes milliseconds, sub-milliseconds, and it's not like in seconds. And this data is going to grow, which means your data centers and your cloud architecture have to grow. Because you will never know when the data is going to explode. So you need a very scalable infrastructure to handle that variability. And more, and we have seen this in the pandemic, this is one side of it, it's on the infrastructure side and data side. What about the employee side? And they need to be enabled with the solid connectivity module so that they can all be constantly in touch with this data. Data collected and stored in a cloud is useless if the people working from home can't access it seamlessly without putting a lot of investment on security and VPN and data lines. That's going to be an important requirement of this digital transformation. And to make this happen, you need an intelligent network. When I say intelligent network, today, the consumption of the network is the same way we consumed hardware 10 years ago. We buy particular fixed capacity, we give 10 Mbps or 1 GB internet, and that pipe is bought and kept with you whether you use it or not. And if you want to connect to three data centers, three cloud, you need to buy three of those. One cannot be used against the other. Now we are changing all that. We are changing where you can consume network as a service, same way you are consuming computing as a service. As people move more and more to cloud, everything has become a subscription-based model. Everything is based as a network consumption model. We are trying to bring the same thing at Airtel as network as service product. And all of this is not possible if the company and company's employees are bringing a digital first mindset. When I say digital first mindset, I'll give you an example from B2B, right? In B2B, when a salesperson is selling to a customer, he has a quota. He has to retire that quota. The minute you introduce digital, the first reaction of the sales rep is quota is going to go up. Because now you're saying, for this customer, a certain part of your ordering will happen online. What is the reaction of that salesperson? The salesperson is going to say, oh my gosh, my quota is going to go up, and he's going to find everything wrong with that digital asset so that customers don't use it. Because for customers, he or she has been the lifeline. Suddenly you are saying some of this can be ordered online. Same thing happens in a B2C setup as well. If you're not a born native B2C company which is digital, you would start with a store. Now you're trying to go digital. And when digital sales takes over, the store managers are very unhappy. Already their stores are going down, COVID situation. Now online is eating into their business. Even within a particular brand, you are not able to enable digital online because it's viewed as a competition to the store. And this has to be an important step in companies' mind when they do the deal with this. We really have to make sure that there's no channel conflict. So in our case, we give credit for all ordering to the same camp. Even if the order comes online, the salesperson gets credit. That way, he or she is incentivized to make sure that the customers can order online, their experience is great, their prices are well set up, prices are well negotiated, and they're all set up on the online world. And so that they find more time to talk to the customers about other products. Now, this is a digital mindset. If I could get this digital mindset to a salesperson, saying, look, digital is actually going to help me to sell more to the customer. So even if my quota goes up, which is reality, I'm getting help. I'm getting enabled so that I can achieve my numbers. Same thing on the B2C world. If you tell a store person that if a customer gets the order online and if it is available in the nearest store, I will ship it from there. So that it counts in your revenue credit also. The store has a big incentive to make online success. All of a sudden, their contribution in revenue goes up. They will make sure the inventory is set properly. They'll make sure that, you know, with the data they collect online, they will know exactly what they need to store to serve not only the customers walking into the store, but also the customers who are buying online. This is the fundamental difference in the way people have to think about this. That's what I call the digital mindset, because when I say digital mindset, every company should think about how digital will make their employees successful and so that they embrace it. digital cannot be seen as a threat. And I imagine when I was growing up as a young boy and computers were introduced, people saw computers as a threat. They thought computers were going to take away the job. You could see strikes and unions protesting it. Today, you can't imagine any operation, whether it's a bank or a government working under a computer. You would see an undercurrent of this in stores when they go digital, because not because they think to lose their job, they think it's not going to make them successful because digital is going to eat their money. And once we talk about this data, the data has to be stored in a place which is scalable. It is going to come from two things. One, if you run your own data centers, it won't be enough, and you won't be able to grow that data center faster. Data center expansion. Moving to the cloud is very expensive. It is not cheaper. People will realize that cloud is, we are paying for variability, right? If you go to a cloud provider and say, I will give you exactly this many machines for the whole year, your price will be much lower than you saying, look, I want variability. I will just place an order whenever I need. So the subscription-based model means that it will be higher. Expansion, your application still not cloud ready, you should go for a co-located model. Now, we have launched amazing partnership with Airtel and Oracle where we can offer them public cloud. So we want to make sure that these data which we talked about, it's stored in our edge data centers, so the latency is lower. And we have about 120 edge data centers. We're building edge data centers also, about 10 core data centers in multiple locations. So Airtel is getting ready to serve security, scalable infrastructure, a smart connectivity, a hybrid workforce, and a digital mindset. We believe these are the five key transformation pillars you need for your own digital transformation. Whether you're a B2B company or a B2C company, the requirements of digital, why digital, the why of digital will be different, both for your customers and you. But the fundamental five pillars are the same. To achieve might be different between B2B and B2C. But that's not all. There's one more thing. And that one more thing is 5G. 5G is going to change this dramatically. 5G brings three things. Amazing low latency network, higher bandwidth, and greater capacity. And this is going to be very, very critical for B2B and in the consumer space. As 5G gets rolled out in Airtel, we're all paying our mobile bills. Hopefully, we'll pay a little bit more when 5G comes to avail this. But the trend we have seen in this country, our telecom mobile bill per user is the lowest compared to other markets. So hopefully, when 5G comes, you'll all enjoy the lower latency and higher bandwidth. You'll be able to watch videos faster, and you will don't mind paying a bit more. But I sincerely believe the opportunity when 5G comes is much, much bigger in the corporate space. We have done some very interesting use cases. For example, with a very big healthcare chain, we are doing what is called a connected ambulance. With 5G, you can actually have your own slice of the spectrum, where if you are a healthcare professional, healthcare hospital, all your ambulances and hospitals are connected. Which means you have your own road structure. Imagine you have your own set of roads connecting all of your ambulances, all of your hospitals, at least data road, so that the constant communication between ambulances and the hospitals are happening on this slice of the spectrum. There's a scary data point that 1 out of 10 ambulance patients die on the way. And if we are able to enable this, it will actually save a lot of lives. The second point is, if you're a car manufacturer, cars are going to be more and more software driven in the future. There's going to be so much data to be updated on the car when they get out of the manufacturing line. Today, it's a very time consuming affair. You're putting almost a USB stick into the car and updating that software. Tomorrow, over the air, with 5G's bandwidth, you should be able to update 10 cars at the same time. This technology is called data shower, which is real, which is there today. The third one which we are very using is that anything which is video-based will become a lot more easier with 5G. So for example, if you're running a very high-quality assembly line, and you need to constantly check for input material, compare it with the quality parameters, and take it off the assembly line if it is not conforming. You can all do that with the lowest latency. Imagine as things are coming up in the assembly line, you can check the part, make sure that it conforms to the quality standard, take a picture, confirm it to the standard using computing, and then take it off the assembly line if it is not. And that kind of power will be made available to your factories. We truly live in a blessed world.